That's the information I gave you last time has to do with old statistics. The new statistics are kind of scary. We talked about this yesterday in another class. We were talking about what are you guys going to have to do? I mean, you're going to be the psychologist, and theoretically, I mean, if you stay on the reservation, what are you going to have to do? And what are you going to find? What are you going to be looking at? Is it going to be a situation where you're only dealing with people that are either not traditional or not very traditional? Or what kind of stuff are you going to be dealing with? What kind of mental illnesses are you going to be dealing with? What kind of addictions are you going to be dealing with? We know there's drugs and alcohol. And right now, of course, there's OxyContin and crystal meth. What's next? What are you going to be dealing with in the future? The problem with the DSM-5 is the DSM-5 is old. That came out in 2013. That's 6 years ago. 6 years ago, fentanyl wasn't on the streets. Now all of a sudden it killed Prince, and who else did it kill? Tom Petty, the heartbreaker guy. Killed him. He had three different types of fentanyl in his system and he died. So the question is, what are you going to be dealing with? I can't teach you what's going to happen in the future. I can't. I just don't know what it is. And we have no clue what it's going to be. But the sexual addiction, this whole pornography thing, this may have something to do with what's going to happen in the future. Even here, despite the fact that according to your traditions, you guys don't focus on sexual things. I mean, we are talking about your children, not my children. My children are older than everybody in the room. my son's graduating from Florida Gulf Coast University on Saturday, and he's 47 years old. So I know Marius is sitting back there, man. Damn, he's old. And you're right, Marius, he is old. And he's my kid. So it's not my kids. I don't have to worry about my kids. My kids are old. They've already been through all this stuff. And when they went through whatever stuff they went through, didn't have anything to do with the internet because it didn't exist at that time. Didn't have to do with games. They used to play that Pong game where, you know, the ball kind of drifts its way up to the corner and you have to catch it and bounce it back. Pong. Yeah, my son used to play Pong. As funny as that is. So the question is, what are you going to be dealing with? Are you going to be dealing with internet gaming? Are you going to be dealing with internet addictions? What else is out there? I mean, we talk about alcohol and we talk about crystal meth, but fentanyl is so much worse. It kills people. You can't. They had a news program on 60 Minutes the other night, and they were talking about fentanyl and where it's coming from. It comes from China, by the way, and it's legal, oddly enough. So they can't really control it. But the stuff is so strong that if you get a bag of fentanyl and you have plastic gloves on, and you open it up, and the dust that comes out could be enough to kill you, to overdose you. The dust that comes out of the bags. So they have to wear respirators when they deal with this stuff. And some of them still overdose, the people dealing with this stuff. So what's going to happen in the future? This is what you need to be aware of. You know, you all want to be counselors, or you all want to work in psychology. The answer is that Sarah and Sue and I don't have the answers. We don't know. The textbooks don't have the answers. I apologize. It's not my fault. I wish I did. I wish I knew where you guys were headed. I wish we could talk about it. We talked about it yesterday, didn't we? Yeah, so, you know, this is one of the things that we need to focus on and to be aware of and to think about, ask questions about these things if you can think about what they are. You guys know where you're headed. I'm 70 years old, and I have no clue What's going on in your high schools right now, I have no idea what kind of messages they're sending back and forth, whether they're sexting or texting or rexting, I don't know. But sometimes they send naked pictures of each other to themselves, I mean to each other, as weird as that sounds. And of course, we had no clue. I mean, when we invented the internet, actually the military invented the internet a long, long time ago, you know, they had no idea what was going to happen. They had no idea that it was going to be used for pornography. What's that? 30% of all internet content is pornography. They had no idea. They had no idea. And I would apologize for the United States military sending you guys all this bad stuff, but they didn't know what you were going to use it for. They're innocent. I mean, the military guys probably are.
Yeah.
Look at all that pornography. That's great stuff. You know, I'm a military. Okay, does everybody have one of these? The only reason I'm giving you this is because I want you to be aware of what's going on in Indian country right now. You know, there are issues off the reservation that have to do with you. And this is one of those situations where the Professional Lacrosse Association is supporting one of the best lacrosse players in the United States. Well, probably the best lacrosse player. And he's an Onondaga from Upper New York State. It ain't here, but it still has to do with American Indians. This has to do with, I was talking to somebody yesterday about the Cleveland Indians and the logo. Okay. Cleveland does not use that logo anymore. Cleveland became known as the Indians. They were the Spiders before. Cool as that is, not Spider-Man, but they were the Spiders. And they broke the major league record for losses in a season. The next year they picked up a first baseman who was a Penobscot, if you know anything about American Indians of the Northeast. He was a Penobscot from Maine, and he was so good that he hit over 400 and he knocked in like half of their runs. And They had a good season, and because of this individual, they renamed the team the Cleveland Indians instead of the Cleveland Spiders. They changed the name of the team, and everybody was just gaga over this guy. It's not a happy story. He ended up dying of alcoholism, so it's not a happy story. But he changed the name of the Cleveland Indians. Changed the name of the Cleveland Spiders to the Cleveland Indians, which is a positive thing. Let me see if I can get this thing working. Come on. Great. My computer's not working. Okay. Anybody have any questions about anything? Everything is due tomorrow. No, everything's due. I know. Oh my God. Yeah. Everything's due. Just get it in. I need to be able to grade it. So if you don't give it to me in time for me to grade it, I get kind of grouchy I get kind of grouchy a lot, okay? And if you guys send me all of your stuff all at once and it's like 3 hours before I have to turn in my grades, I'm not going to be very nice to you, okay? I love you guys, but obviously you hate me because you're torturing me like this. just get it in. I have a problem with grading papers. I have to correct everything. It's really kind of sad. I know he's in your seat.
Sorry. Got me a little surprise.
You can punch him if you want.
I'm okay.
If you start crying, he'll move. Come on. Go away. this is what happens when I turn on my computer. I get all this stuff telling me I've got crap on my computer. What were we just talking about? Pornography? It's probably thinks I have pornography on my computer. There we go. Okay. We need to finish this chapter, and then we'll start talking about pharmaceuticals. Gee, my Christmas. We'll start talking about pharmaceuticals. Yeah, because we need to talk about pharmaceuticals before you get out of here. So we need to be really careful about our sexual addiction. Pornography is a sexual addiction. There's just a ton of different types. You're going to run into these if you get into any type of counseling. You're going to run into these from time to time, and you have to deal with them. You don't really have a choice. I was talking to somebody yesterday, and they were saying, well, we could just ignore them. And the answer to that is, well, if you do, then you're not going to be able to fix anybody. If somebody's got a sexual addiction, you need to deal with it. You need to deal with all of their problems. If you don't deal with all their problems, if they're depressed and they're an alcoholic, you can't, if you get rid of their alcoholism, it's not going to take away their depression. That's not the way it works. You've got to deal with everything that they have a problem with. If they have a relationship problem, you have to deal with the relationship. You can't ignore anything. I'm sorry. We used to play that game, and there are different types of counseling techniques where you just focus on the here and now and not on the past. A lot of those times, they fix that, but this person still has a problem. Somebody was molested as a three-year-old. Well, unless you talk about what happened to them as a three-year-old, the depression that they have today is you may be able to fix it for right now, but it's going to come back because their depression is really being caused by the fact that they were molested as a three-year-old and they haven't dealt with it. So this is not something that you can ignore. None of these problems are anything that you can ignore. If they have a family problem, you have to deal with the family. You have to deal with their problems. Okay? I'm sorry. I wish we could just pretend that something doesn't happen. I mean, this isn't a lot of fun to deal with. This is hard. This is really hard stuff. I told you that when I was living, where was I? I was in Mississippi, and I was helping a consultant on individuals that were in prison for molesting people or raping somebody. And we were the ones that had to decide whether they would get out of jail or not. That was tough. And we had to go back through their cases, and we had to figure out what were their triggers, and would they have they taken care of their triggers in prison? It was tough. It was really, really hard. So that's one of the things that you need to think about. That you're going to have to get down and dirty with these individuals just in order to understand what their problem is. They're going to be using F words, words that start with F. Fun. They're going to use that word a lot, actually. And you're going to have to deal with this, and you're going to have to be able to deal with this. And I apologize that you can't censor what they say when they come into your office, but that's just the way it works. Okay, so there are lots of different sexual addictions. We talked about some of the fetishes. These are in the DSM-4 TR. They're also in the DSM-5, the new one that came out in 2013. So we've got a lot of different problems that potentially these individuals can have. Exhibitionism, where they display themselves to select individuals. It's usually somebody that's weak. It's usually a child, strangely enough. But it could be a woman. It could be an adult woman that they display themselves to. Of course, if you go to a strip joint, then those are people that are exhibiting themselves for money. Is that right or is that wrong? I don't know. Is it right or wrong to display yourself to somebody? Is it wrong? What about sexting? But I was in love with her, so I showed her a picture of my junk. I'll tell you what jumped me. Is that okay?
It really would depend on culture, wouldn't it?
It does depend on culture, but
And the sequence and display as well.
Exactly.
The procedure and what is being processed.
Exactly.
For instance, standing on top of the stage, doing that morally probably is wrong.
Wait a minute, you've seen that movie? What was that?
Morally, or economically, looking at economic standards today.
Money?
So those are also possibilities?
Wow, gee, Christmas, this is terrible. So is it right or is it wrong? I told you about Germany. In Germany on Thursday night, everybody's naked at the Schwimmbad. I'm not walking around town. If you go swimming on Thursday night at the Schwimmbad, everybody's naked. Is that right or wrong? Well, in their culture, it's okay, I guess. Nudity doesn't mean the same thing as it does in the United States. We don't have the same, they don't have the same morality that we do. They have brothels, they have prostitutes. If you ever go to Germany and you see a woman standing with her ankles crossed, and I can barely do it, but if they cross their ankles, it means they're open for business, as it were, and they're looking for a client. How about that? Acceptable behavior, but in the United States, prostitution is against the law. Right? Mm-hmm. Except in that one county in Nevada. So this is really kind of interesting, the way it works, isn't it? So when we're talking about addictions, and we're talking about morality, and we're talking about ethics, it all depends on where you are. I would imagine that the laws in Mormon country up in Utah are completely different than they are any place else in the United States. For one thing, their legal limit for drunkenness is half of what it is in all the other states in the Union. So I would imagine their idea of morality is a little bit different. Exhibitionism, fetishism, frecherism, we talked about that last time. Frecherism is where you rub up against somebody inappropriately or you fondle them. Like I said last time, this is a really serious problem in Japan where it's so crowded and everybody's right up next to each other. I told you the story about when I was in Japan and all those stewardesses. Oh, jeez, I was so embarrassed. I got on the train and they all just surrounded me, and as we were bouncing along, of course, I thought I was getting a standing lap dance. It was kind of exciting. Or it would have been. And I'm stiff as a board, I'm afraid to touch anybody, or even to loosen my muscles, afraid that they would think that I was trying to touch them or something, which probably happened with Americans from time to time. Pedophilia, of course, has to do with children. Oh, wait a minute. I'll tell you what. I'm going to show you a video, okay? Don't worry. This is... Oh, come on. It's a song for the 1980s. Don't get excited. I think. Wait a minute. I got to show you this. I was going to show Marius the other day. But I decided not
to. Don't
worry. He's real sensitive, and I was afraid I would... embarrassing. I didn't want to do that. You guys are a little tougher, we've been talking about this stuff all year. Okay, wait a second. Who am I? No, I gotta show you this. This has to do with pedophilia. Alright. This is a popular song from the 1980s. You may recognize it. I know Francis will recognize it. This guy's name is Benny Mardonis. Let me see. Show history. It's not going to show me anything, is it? I need YouTube. I need Benny Mardonis. Come on. Wait a minute. Benny Mardonis. Okay, here we go. There's Benny. This gets kind of strange. I sent this to my wife yesterday. Oh, come on, let's have some more noise. Oh, it's the wrong one. Wait a minute, that's just too spooky for me. Wait a minute.
We need the whole thing. We don't want... This is a song called Into the Night. Oh, that's the same damn thing. Wait a minute. That's not right. That's not the right one. Wait a minute. Let me give you another one. How do I get rid of this? Where are you, Benny? I did this yesterday and it came right up. Okay, let's do... I'll show you that one. Ain't he cool? That this came back in 1989 and it was a hit twice. I mean, the song's a pretty good song. I mean, it starts out with she's just 16 years old. It gets creepier, okay? Hit twice. My jam? Yeah. It is one of my jams. Until I saw the video. The video creeps me out. 16 years old, is that legal? He looked a little older. The guy with the beard told him she's only 16 years old. I know, a little freaky, a little spooky. Okay, we're talking about pedophilia. And here's a song from 1980 where it supports that type of activity, as stupid as that sounds. And some of the stuff that he does. Did you see the look on her face? What look? She had no emotion showing on her face at all. That was weird. Okay, he's trying to seduce this lady, and this little child. And instead of her reacting, she just has a blank look on her face through the whole thing, through the whole video. I'm just shocked. I've never seen the video before. I just found it like a couple weeks ago. But, I've been listening to this song since 1980.
Pink socks.
I know the pink socks. I need to find me some pink socks.
I think you probably Google pink socks and I came up.
He's not the best looking guy in the world either.
Pink
I know.
Socks and a rug.
He throws the rug in. Anyway, pedophilia. Pedophilia. Of course, we all know what pedophilia is. It has to do with seducing children or raping children. That's pedophilia. And as far as I'm concerned, 16 years old is way too young for anybody, especially somebody that looks like him. Anyway, pedophilia. Sexual masochism is where you enjoy people hurting you. Sexual sadism, of course, is where you like hurting other people. Now, interestingly enough, these two types of people will get together. They call it sadomasochism, where one likes to hurt the people and the other likes being hurt. And they've got it's a match made in wherever you think matches are made. At least we don't have a masochist that marries some normal person or anyway. Transvestic fetishism is where the individual dresses like the opposite sex. Relatively common. Voyeurism, of course, that was kind of voyeurism, wasn't it? He's peeking in her window. That was a little spooky. Maybe just a little bit. Anyway, voyeurism is where you get sexual gratification from watching people doing things in the privacy of their own home, like changing their clothes. That's voyeurism.
Transvestic
fetishism?
Yeah, is that the same as cross-dressing?
Cross-dressing, yeah, that's what it is. Okay. Yeah. What's the difference between a cross-dresser and somebody who has transvestic fetishism? This individual can only get sexual gratification from dressing like the opposite sex. That's
but
the difference.
Is the same, they're dominant?
Yes. Okay. This person, it's interrupting with their lives. People wear the opposite. Men will wear women's underwear and whatnot. It's the brassiere that gets a little strange when they wear the brassiere. But if they wear the opposite sex clothes to get sexual gratification, then it's transvestic fetishism. If they can only get sexual gratification from cross-dressing, in essence. A lot of people cross-dress. Okay. Other sexual addictions include love addiction, the desire to fall in love and to be in love. Love addiction, this usually has to do with an individual that focuses on a select individual. There was a case at Purdue University where a professor, a very famous professor, died, and the librarian claimed that they had been lovers for 15 or 20 years,
And the reality was that he had no idea, or if they could have asked him, he had no idea who she was. But she had this love addiction, this fetish, that she focused on him. And so she, when they went into her house, they found that she had, any time he had checked out a book and signed his name, she had stolen the card. She had all this pile of stuff that had his name in it. He had no clue who she was, but she, of course, had this strange love addiction for that select individual. There are individuals who are addicted to relationships. They'll bounce from one relationship to the other. They can't be without a relationship. They have to be in a relationship all the time. We've talked about when somebody breaks up with somebody else, usually if it's a female, it takes her about 2 years to get over it. If it's a male, it takes him a little bit longer, about 2.5 years. This is all relatively common. But this individual can't, sometimes they have to maintain more than one relationship at a time. I had a girlfriend like this once upon a time. Yes, that's true. I had a girlfriend once. I know it's hard to believe, but yes, I had a girlfriend once, but I wasn't her only boyfriend. Eventually, she got married and she wanted to maintain the relationship, our relationship, which was fairly physical at the time, despite the fact that she had just gotten married to somebody else, which seems a little odd to me. And being kind of stupid, I didn't know what to do. I'm not real bright. Exactly. So she left her husband, and I'm thinking, well, now she's my girlfriend. Well, she was, but she was also somebody else's girlfriend at the same time. She had to maintain two relationships at the same time. It's really kind of an odd situation. One that I'm not proud of. I was just in the relationship for physical pleasure, I guess.
How does one get like that?
What, me? I don't know. I don't know how I got that. I was just kind of lonely, I guess. You mean how did she get like that? She was really a fascinating person. I'm just teasing. It was really kind of fascinating because she had been, she had had lots and lots of boyfriends in her time. And of course, guys will do this from time a lot. But for a female to do it, it's not really as acceptable as a man playing the field, having a wife and a mistress at the same time. You know, this is relatively common. Well, we just saw that with the president, right? His wife gave birth to a child and he's having an affair with a Playboy bunny. That's what came out of the Mueller report. You can read it if you like. It's not that much fun. It doesn't seem to be that much fun. But this is very common for males, but when it happens with a female, it's seen as not as acceptable. Her point was that if men can do it, women should be able to do it too. Eventually, we had that conversation. Most of the time, I'm just like lost. I have no idea what was going on. I know it was a sad situation. And I'm doing this one of these kinds of things because I'm just having a good time. I'm just out for a good time. So I kind of closed my eyes and pretended everything was fine. Of course, she was maintaining three relationships at the same time. She was married to one guy. She was dating. She was having an affair with me, and she was having an affair with somebody else. Because when she left her husband, she already had somebody else on the line. Boys on the side. You've seen that movie. I know, it's kind of weird. All right, anyway. Individuals suffering from any sexual addiction maintain little, if any, control over their behavior despite adverse consequences. A lot of times they don't have control over this. A lot of times they learn this behavior as children. So they saw it in their mother, they saw it in their father, and they think that this is the way to do things. This is one of the reasons why if you have an individual with one of these types of addictions, you have to take them back to their youth. You have to take them back to when they were younger so that they can talk about it, so they can talk about where this came from. Now remember, when you start talking to these individuals, when they saw this at age 3 years old, they saw it as a three-year-old. And so it got stuck in their minds as an immature three-year-old. So sometimes all you need to do is talk about it one time, get them to admit that this is what they're thinking, and when they start thinking about it as a 25 or 30 year old, it doesn't make any sense anymore, and it goes away. I know, that's kind of exciting. So sometimes all you need to do is talk about it one time to make it go away. Now the bizarre part, you know, I told you we were doing that consulting with the sexual offenders in Ohio. Sometimes these individuals, nobody had ever done this with them before. And so when we started talking to them, and we asked them about where this came from, and we took them back all the way back to their childhood, a lot of times this is the first time they'd ever done that. And they went, "This is stupid. Why in the world am I doing this?" Let me tell you a quick story. So he was doing the consulting. I was consulting with the consultant is what was happening. But he had one client that came in. The guy had he was prostituting. What do they call that? When they're the ones that run the prostitutes. What do they call that? Wait a minute.
Trick.
Oh no. He's the pimp. That's it. He was pimping women out. And he had been arrested for beating one of them up and raping her. So he was going to go to jail. Well, his wife came in with him, which is kind of interesting. And she was this drop dead gorgeous woman, wore hardly any clothes, showing skin all over the place, and you would think, well, she's a stripper or something, you know, he's married a stripper. Wasn't that way at all. She was a lot younger, kind of like just 16 years old. But it was really kind of interesting because the guy, there was not a whole lot they could do with the guy, but the young lady seemed like she should have been okay. He was going to go to jail, she's going to have to take care of herself. But what she did, would flirt with this guy, would flirt with the counselor. And he thought that was a little weird. The guy finally went to prison and she came back for counseling. She wanted him to counsel her. And of course the first thing she tried to do was seduce him, because this is the way that she functioned. She seduced men. As it turned out, she had been sexually molested by the friends of her husband, and her husband would pimp her out to his friends, as stupid as that sounds. And she would deal with that type of a situation. But she wanted to change, and so when she came in, of course, the only way that she knew to interact with males was to try to seduce them. And of course, she was, like I said, she was very, very attractive. And she had no problem seducing just about anybody. But when they started talking, as it turned out, she was raised primarily by her father. She was a daddy's girl. Her mother ignored her. She didn't like her because she was so pretty. Her father started paying a lot more attention to her than he did to his wife. So she grew up as her father's... She was a daddy's girl, so she hung out with her dad. She knew how to fix cars. She knew, she hung out with her father. But her father, there was something wrong with him a little bit, and he wouldn't pay attention to her unless she flirted with him. And this started when she was like 5 or 6 years old. It's not like he was raping his daughter or having sex with his daughter or anything else was happening. But that's the only time he would pay attention to her, if she flirted with him. And so she grew up with this mindset that this is how you deal with men that you love. You flirt with them. And so she had this whole flirtation thing going on. So eventually, of course, my friend wasn't seduced by this individual. His wife was also a counselor, and she took over the counseling this young lady. And as soon as the counselor took her back to her earlier years and told her what she was doing, she stopped. She had been this extremely sexual person, always wearing, dressing provocatively, always flirting with guys, ignoring women. She had no women, female friends at all. Nobody liked her because she was always stealing everybody's boyfriends. So she had no female friends. Well, as soon as she realized what was going on, as soon as she explained to her that she was that she had needed to do this in order to get attention from her father, it all stopped. All she needed to do was hear it one time. And it was like a light bulb went on, or a light bulb went off. I don't know how you like to look at this. She started dressing differently. She actually couldn't see very well. So she started wearing glasses. She changed her hairstyle. She finished her GED, then she went to college. She became a counselor, interestingly enough. I know it's really kind of weird. She divorced that jerky guy. Now, and you ask yourself, why in the world would she marry this horrible person? Well, the reason was because he reminded her of her father, and she was trying to seduce her father. She was trying to marry her father. As weird as that sounds. I know. Exactly. So all they needed to do is take her back to her childhood, and you know, this was an innocent thing as far as she was concerned. She just kind of drifted into this flirtatious attitude, and as soon as they took her back to her youth, and she looked at her life, she realized that she'd been doing this all of her life, and she changed. She made a 180-degree change, and she became an academic, as it were. Before, she was, you know, very flirtatious and very seductive, extremely seductive. Another case, why am I talking about this? Oh, we're talking about relationships. Sorry. Another case, this is the first counseling case I ever had. The lady came in, she was a pilot's wife. And she always dressed in really skimpy clothes. So I came in to counsel her, and she sat down across from me. And of course, I'm a Rogerian, so you know, you sit there and you with your legs open, and you want to counsel somebody, so you're really open to what they have to say. You show them that you're open to everything. So you're sitting like this, and you're leaning forward. Okay, so. And she's like right there. And so I start to counsel her, and all of a sudden she starts flipping her hair. She has this really long hair, and it's kind of reddish brown, and she keeps flipping her hair. And every time she leaned over, she's got this sundress on. Guess what happened next? Okay. Anyway. Okay, so you get in the picture. This lady's flipping her hair, bending over and flipping her hair, and of course her dress is a sundress. So it's Lubbock, Texas. It's nice and hot. So her dress is slowly inching up her legs, and she's got her legs kind of apart. And of course I'm sitting there like this, and I've got my legs apart, and she's got her legs apart. And pretty soon, after about the third flip of her hair, my legs start going closer and closer together. I'm squeezing them together. And we've got a video of this thing. And as the counseling session progressed, I'm getting more and more. I'm scooting back. I'm covering myself with my hands like this. She's scaring me to death. And the more I'm doing this, the more she's displaying herself. Okay. All right. Yeah. Okay. I didn't react very well to her. I will have to admit, I didn't react very well to her. But. What the deal was, she was a daddy's girl also. She was a daddy's girl, and she flirted with her dad. Of course, it was all innocent flirtation, didn't have anything to do with anything else. So this was her way of dealing with men. This is her gaining power over men. She would do these provocative things, and it would, of course, it would... make them react positively to her. That's what she wanted. Because her dad would always react to her when she did these things. Now here's the bizarre part. She had just gotten married, and her husband complained that she was a tease, and she wouldn't have sex with him. She would take a shower and walk around the house with just a towel on. And if he tried to seduce her, she would get really angry with him. And so she came in saying that her husband was over sex. This was the problem that we were supposed to be dealing with. But the reality was, this lady was extremely provocative, and she did this all the time. So I'm counseling her. She came over to my house in a bicycling outfit. I don't know if you've ever seen a bicycling outfit, but it's really, really tight, right? And of course, she's doing the whole hair flipping thing, and it was hot, so she had to unzip her top. And, oh, geez, come on, lady.
That song come on?
Huh? She wanted to see my house because I was enlisted and she was an officer, and she'd seen officers' houses, but she'd never seen an enlisted man's house. She wanted to know if it was any different than her house. So let's go see. Oh, is this the bedroom? You know, that kind of deal. Oh, come on. Let's be real. I'm such a wimp sometimes.
This be played out as seen as like the for males, like how Alfred Hitchcock's movie, The Psycho.
The Psycho, exactly. 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 Okay, so what eventually happened to this lady? She had married the guy because he was like her dad. So she wanted to treat him like she did her dad. She wanted to treat him like she did her father. And of course her dad never touched her. But she wouldn't let this guy touch her. And of course, he was going crazy. Eventually, she divorced him and she married somebody else who didn't remind her of her dad. The biggest problem was her dad had just died. So she was really after somebody who was just like her father. She was trying to re-find her father. All we had to do was take her back to her adolescence, which is when she started flirting with her dad. All we had to do was take her back to that at that point, and she realized that what she was doing. And of course she changed, and as soon as she changed, this is the sad part, as soon as she realized what was going on, and it only took a couple sessions for her to realize that, she realized she wasn't really in love with the guy that she married. She married her father was a businessman. He was a real outgoing individual. He was real extroverted. She married a pilot who was, all pilots are,
what's the word I'm looking for? Asshole?
So she married somebody who was just like her dad. And once she realized that she had done that, one of the things that she did, she had to divorce him because she didn't really like her dad that much. She loved him, but she didn't like him. You know, it was one of those kind of things. And she married an artist. He was long-haired, and her husband was broad-shouldered. And was the center on the basketball team. All that kind of stuff. Anyway, relationship addiction. So people can have these relationship addictions, and sometimes they're looking for a specific relationship. You probably have friends that they keep getting in relationships with it. The guy beats them up, and you go, what are you doing with him? And they say, well, I love him, that kind of deal. Their picker's broke. They don't really like the guy, but they get in that relationship anyway. And so they have to change relationships on a relatively frequent basis. Or they get married 4 or 5 times, and, the one guy knocks out her upper teeth, and another guy knocks out her lower teeth. All of a sudden, she just keeps getting hooked up with these really bad people. Well, their picker's broken, and they have relationship addiction. They have to get into these relationships. And they're getting into the same relationship that is very similar to their father. Individuals suffering from any sexual addiction maintain little or any control over their behavior, despite the adverse consequences. It seems like they have to get into these relationships over and over and over and over again. So they finally get rid of the abuser, and so who do they marry? They marry an alcoholic that's also an abuser. We see this a lot in families where the parents are alcoholics. As far as the children are concerned, that's normal. Drinking is normal, and that type of behavior is normal. So when they're looking for normal, of course, we're all looking for normal. They find somebody else who's an alcoholic. And of course, sometimes it's an abusive alcoholic or whatever. But if they divorce that person, so now they're looking for love. Well, who are they going to find? They're going to find somebody else who's an alcoholic. My first wife wasn't an alcoholic. My first wife wanted me to hit her, and I'm not a puncher. Sorry. Obviously, I didn't love her very much. I couldn't punch her. But her second husband was a cowboy, and he just wailed the tar out of her. She was so attractive, and she was so much in love with him. You know, he knocked out some of her teeth, which is always attractive. And then her next husband was a truck driver, and he wailed the tar out of her as well. I mean, that's true love. Obviously, I didn't love her. I couldn't hit her hard enough or spank her. She wanted to be spanked. I won't go into the rest of that. why are we talking about this? The individual will continue to obsess over the behavior to the distraction of everything else. And of course, they are obsessing over these things. What could I do to show her my love with my first wife? If I didn't hit her, she didn't think I loved her. If she made me angry and I didn't punch her, then obviously I didn't really love her. Obviously. Isn't it obvious? I couldn't possibly love her unless I knocked her teeth out. Anyway. I'm sorry.
because I keep thinking, the state of Native America today, right?
Sure.
And not just in Navajo country, but all over, as you mentioned at the beginning of class. These kind of issues are major.
And everybody's got a different culture. I told you guys that up north, everybody has hickeys. That's how they show love, is by sucking on somebody's neck. As weird as that sounds. Grandma. You guys think I'm kidding. You go to a powwow, they got their shawl, their fancy shawl, and they got a whole ring of hickeys. You guys are such wimps. But sometimes it's more destructive than that. And there are physical abusers and whatnot. And of course, this is something that you guys are going to have to deal with, not me. I don't have to deal with this. I'm not going back up north. I'm not going to settle in Montana on the Indian reservation up there. I'm not going to stay here forever. I'll be here as long as I am. And you guys are going to be the ones that are going to need to deal with this. And you need to figure out what's normal and what's not normal for your culture. And there may be more than one culture. I was talking to somebody last night, and he was saying that his wife lives 30 miles away from where she was from, 30 miles away from where he was, and her traditions were completely different from his. He said, basically, they're the same. They sound like the same. It's kind of like the difference between Protestantism and Catholicism. But when you get down deep into how they act, completely different. His wife, and she's only 30 miles away. She lives up on the mesa, and he lives down in the valley. And that's the difference between two Navajo groups, between just 30 minutes apart.
Wow.
I know. It's weird.
It's interesting, because how do you deal with that? Right? As Navajo people?
Yeah.
As looking into family structures, death, all these kind of lineages, situations in various different areas, it's extremely complicated, because some of these acts are conducted by well-known headmen.
Exactly.
How do you attack it? How do you fix it?
Right.
As Native students, right? How do you all do that? What's your approach? These things are something we all need to think about. Right? And how do we, we're looking at fixing and developing things, right? Organizing,
right?
Structure.
And things are going to change over time. I mean, are we going to follow whatever Wilson tells us, because he wrote a book in 1991? Is that the final book on how Navajos act? I mean, he's from west of here, isn't he? Isn't he from west? Yeah. He's not from here. He's not from Crown Point. He's not from from Crystal, he's from west of here. So maybe his nolly gave him different information than what you, what the information that you have. Now, that's what he was saying. It was the grandmother's. His grandmother told him to do this, and her grandmother told her to do, told her to do something totally different. And now they're raising children, and they have to decide which is right. Is it her grandmother's ideas or his grandmother's ideas that are correct? He has five brothers, and two of them married Navajos, and the other three have married outside the tribe. One's married to an Asian, and two are married to Hispanics. And of course, the grandmother won't have anything to do with those three guys because they've done something incorrect as far as she was concerned.
I know.
It's interesting because we're talking about all this and just kind of observing this whole process, right? Students here taking these courses. It's like we're opening the realm of Hojong, right? And so they're understanding the material, getting the weaponry, you know, getting instilled all that into them. And then going out to face these kind of issues that are out there.
Right, but these guys are going to have to be dealing with everybody. And they're going to be dealing with traditionals, they're going to be dealing with partial traditionals, and Mormons, and Catholics, and all kinds of things. And so where are the ideas coming from? That's the biggest question. As much fun as all this is. Okay. And like I said, you're going to have to deal with it, not me. I don't have to worry about it. I'm leaving. I'm out of here. I'm going home. I'm going to Iowa, where the Indians are different. Them Meskwakis up there, and they're foxes. And I don't know if you understand the story of the Meskwaki. The French decided that the Meskwaki were too powerful. So they decided to eradicate them, genocide. So they hunted them down wherever they were. And as long as the French were controlling the Canadian area, the Meskwaki had no place to go. And they just kept fleeing, and they kept chasing them. And they started out over on the East Coast, up near Quebec, and they ended up in Iowa, being chased by the French, who would kill every damn single one of them if they caught them. They didn't just kill the warriors, they killed the women, they killed all the children. They wanted to eradicate the tribe, and they ended up in hiding in Iowa. If you've ever been to Iowa, it's a bunch of hills, so you can't see from one place to the other. Anyway, they were able to hide, and they still survive to this day. They have one of the largest casinos in that part of the country. Not that that's important. Okay, compulsive sexual behavior is repeated because of the release of the pleasure-inducing neurotransmitters. We talked about this before. Dopamine, enkephalin, and endorphin. Tolerance to these neurotransmitters leads to a need for the addict to spend more and more time in their sexual activity to gain the same mental benefits. So whereas when he first started looking at pornography, it took him 15 minutes before he felt good, now all of a sudden he's got to stay on the internet for hours in order to get the same feeling at the end. And this is the way sexual addiction works. This is the way murders, the individuals that are sexual murderers, they will use pornography to trigger themselves. And what they're trying to do is they're trying to become excited enough so that they can go out and murder and rape. Ted Bundy did this. Who's the other guy? John Wayne Gacy, the clown, that would go out and grab little boys and murder and rape and murder them. And bury them in his attic, in his basement, in his backyard. John Wayne Gacy would do this. So this is, this has to do with addiction. And these are something that we need to be aware of. So if you're a forensic psychologist, and you've got an individual, and I can assure you if there is a sexual murderer on the reservation, the FBI is going to come in and they're not going to have any clue about you guys, none whatsoever. And they're going to try to profile that sexual murderer as if he were some guy back in Washington, D.C., living in an urban area. And it's not going to be true at all. You're going to have to be dealing with this. Once upon a time in Omaha, Nebraska, there was a guy that was grabbing little 12-year-old boys, blonde-headed, blue-eyed boys, and he was raping and murdering them. And I was working right next door. I was in Springfield, Nebraska. And I was coaching a freshman basketball team. Of course, these guys were 13 or 14 years old. And almost all of them were blonde-headed and blue-eyed. And I told them, look, you don't go anywhere by yourself. You need to buddy up at this point. This guy is a murderer. You don't know who he is. Evidently, he's able to induce these individuals to come close enough to him so that he can grab them. And he takes them out, rapes them, and murders them. And this happened 3 times. And we were trying to figure out who it was. Of course, at the time, I was a basketball coach and an English teacher. I was not a psychologist. I wasn't. And the individual that was doing the profiling for this guy was a psychiatrist. And he was trying to say that he made this profile out of this individual. I said, I don't think that's right. I think this is a military guy. And it's not just a military guy, it's a young military guy. For one thing, he wore a black hat. Nobody wore black hats back then except military. Watch cap, it's a stocking cap. And I said, I think it's a young military guy. And he said, no, can't be a military guy. They saw his car, so they looked for his car all over the place. They were looking for all over Bellevue, Nebraska, all over Omaha, all over Plattsmouth, which is just south of the Air Force Base. And he was snatching these kids right near the Air Force Base. And I said, I think he's a military guy. I think it's a young military guy. As it turned out, I was right, he was wrong, but it took, that third kid died before they found him, because they wouldn't look on the base. He was wrong. I had just gotten out of the service. I had a feeling that I knew how these kids talked. I knew what was going on. He was an older gentleman, and he didn't think so. So we used to argue all the time, and he would tell me things like, well, you've only got a master's degree in psychology. I don't think you know what the hell you're talking about. And I said, well, you haven't been around these people, and I think you know what you're talking about. And as it turned out, he didn't know what he's talking about, and I was right. Unfortunately, I was right. It was a military guy. Anyway, so why are we talking about this? Building up tolerance. Oh, so what this kid was, the reason he was snatching these kids is because he was playing Dungeons and Dragons, and his character did this kind of stuff. This character grabbed young boys and raped them and murdered them. But it was his character. It was his, what do they call, avatar. You know, and this guy never even heard of Dungeons and Dragons. The psychiatrist had never even heard of Dungeons and Dragons. And of course, this kid was so imbued in this idea. So every time that he played Dungeons and Dragons, he felt like he needed to go out and rape and murder somebody. It was his trigger. And he'd play Dungeons and Dragons all weekend long, and if it triggered what he needed to do, he would go out and rape and murder somebody. Usually it was on Sunday morning. And he would grab kids that were paper boys. And he would grab them, take them out, rape them, and murder them. Anyway, as ugly as that is. So we're talking about triggers. Damage can be done to careers, relationships, self-image, and peace of mind, of course. So this is one of the things that you have to be aware of. Sexual addiction becomes the driving force in the addict's life. Part of the drive for the addict may be the risk that they are taking to achieve their target behavior. Usually the addict will culminate the behavior through orgasm, though in some cases it may involve exposure or fondling. With voyeurism, of course, it has to do with fondling. The trigger behavior is often followed by remorse, by guilt, by fear of discovery, resolution to stop the behavior, of course, anytime. It's like the alcoholic that comes home and after he beat up his wife, he'll never do it again. He feels really, really bad about it. That's the last drink he's ever going to take. By golly, until next time. Until next time. Mm-hmm. I had a student up north that she had a boyfriend, and every time he drank whiskey, he would beat her up. So this happened one time, and of course it's never going to happen again. His friends took him out and fed him whiskey, and it wasn't his fault. He didn't have to drink the whiskey. Well, that's not talking about. He had to drink the whiskey because it was his friends. Okay, everybody knows. So the next time that he beat her up, she gave him the whiskey. She gave him the whiskey. And the third time he beat her up, she gave him the whiskey. So what does that tell you about her? He tried to stop it. He always swore that he was going to stop. But of course, he went through all these steps. And eventually, of course, she left him and married somebody else. Sexual behavior is often pursued with a sense of desperation, self-loathing, despair, and low self-image. A lot of times you'll find a significant other that makes you feel bad. And the reason that you marry them is because you feel like you need to feel bad. You want to feel bad. You have self-loathing. You don't like yourself, so you marry somebody that you don't like. Or somebody that hurts you. Or somebody that makes you feel worse. I think your thing just buzzed. I got it in my fingertips. Internet addicts seem to have no control over their need to log on. While the internet didn't really begin until 1991, it really wasn't functional until 1993. It's been around since the 70s, but it was only the military had access to it. We were using it to target, just in case we had a nuclear war. As soon as the nuclear threat was gone in 1989, the wall went down. By 1991, it was all over the United States. By 1993, everybody was using it. Everybody had access to it. But this all had to do with the United States military. We were using it to target. GPS and GIS, same thing. We were using GPS and GIS to target sites in Russia, China, wherever we had enemies, we were going to blow the holy hell out of them. Today, 2.5 million people worldwide out of 7 billion people are connected to the internet. I just looked this up this morning. 3.2 billion is the estimate of people in the world who have access to the internet. 15 to 20% of the 1 billion have high-speed connections. In Canada and the United States, two-thirds of the population are connected to the internet. Some cities are connected. New York City, for example, you don't have to worry about buying internet access because it's all over the city. So you can pick it up from your neighbor. When I was in Los Angeles, visiting my son back when he was in Los Angeles, I was able to steal his neighbor's internet in order to get online. I was grading papers or something. The three main uses of the internet are gaming, seeking erotic material, as we said before, a lot of people looking at pornography, and gambling. Most of the people that are looking at pornography are male, between 90 and 95% of males look at pornography, so this is relatively common. We've discussed gambling before. We talked about gambling before, didn't we? I would never watch a television show where people were playing poker. It seems so silly to me. I watch a football game and watch people knock the crap out of each other. But in poker, what the hell's going on? What are you watching anyway? But this internet gambling is really popular with people, as strange as that may seem. But I don't gamble, so maybe I don't understand these things. The internet, of course, is anonymous. Nobody knows who you are. Theoretically, you can change your identity. It's relatively inexpensive. It's controlled by the user. You can turn it on or turn it off anytime you want. It's validating because if you think that your nose is too big, you can get an avatar that has a small nose, as attractive as that is. It's very rewarding because it makes you feel good about yourself, whereas the reality may be different. It was Donald Trump that was talking about the 400-pound individual in Detroit that was hacking the DNC's internet, their emails. The reality is, of course, that, maybe he did. know why I'm talking about that. Convenient, it's convenient, and it's, of course, a way to escape. Symptoms of internet addiction include logging on at every chance at home or at work. Not addicts log on an average of 8 hours a week. Addicts will log on 8 hours a day, 40 hours a week. Obsessing about the internet, feeling irritable and anxious when you're not online, like you're missing something, like your friends might be trying to get a hold of you and you can't get a hold of them. How many times do you check your email? How many times do you check your email?
Have you checked it at all today?
I haven't either. I haven't checked my email. My goodness.
Sunday, you checked it Sunday. You haven't checked it today.
This morning you go to check, or you go to check it again.
You have friends, maybe they want to get a hold
of you. Just once a day? Once a day? 3 or 4 times a day?
A lot.
A lot?
Every hour.
Every hour you check the internet?
Not the internet, my email.
Oh, your email, of course. How many times a day?
My email?
Yeah.
Every day.
Twice?
Twice? Twice an hour?
There you go.
Sherry, how often do you check your email?
Like
a day.
A day?
A day.
Is it
one or two? All of them. How many email accounts do you have? What? 3 times? That's 3. What?
Twice?
For both of them. See, how about you? Oh, it's the other one on your phone. Four times a day? Is that obsessed? Well, according to this, it is. If you check your email more than once a day, then you're obsessed with your email. If I email Sarah, Dr. Pine, she emails me back within 5 minutes. Okay, yeah, she's really good. Evidently, she gets it on her phone, I'm thinking, because I check, and she gets mad at me if I don't get back to her within, 15 or 20 minutes. And I only check my email once a day, so I have to be really lucky to have checked it right when she wanted me to.
Should
I
hook it up to your phone?
Yeah, she doesn't think I care.
No, you should hook it up to your phone.
Why? I don't even think.
I'll hook my email to my phone.
No, that's crazy. Isn't it?
Well, I don't know.
Do I want to communicate with people that much?
Well, my job, I connect with mentees, and my job is basically
right.
Email-based.
Right.
Yeah.
So I guess this is a warning. I only check my email like once or twice a day. So if you email me and are expecting that I'm going to get back to you like Sarah does within 5 minutes, you're probably SOL. I apologize.
I call you.
He does.
Can you check it? Respond.
I do not know how to get text messages. I don't know how. And so I've got, if you look at my text messages, like I've got 50 from Marius, but times he was trying to get a hold of me and I didn't check. I don't know how. I don't know how to do it. It pisses my daughter off. And every time she sees me, she goes, "Here, Dad, this is the way you do it." And then she does, "Oh, yeah." "There. Now you do it." And I'm going, "I don't know." And she says, "Oh, you're so stupid." I'm not. I'm not stupid. I would. I could if I wanted to. Okay, so you log on a lot. You're obsessed about the internet. You lose track of time when you're online. So if you ever go home at night and all of a sudden the next thing you know it's 1 o'clock in the morning, because I'm hoping you weren't looking at pornography. Let's pretend
Netflix.
You were just reading the internet or reading your email. My wife will do this. I will call her on the telephone and she'll say, "I'm on Facebook, I can't talk to you right now." And I call her back like 3 hours later and she says, "I'm still on Facebook. You know, I'll call you back when I'm done." And she calls me back the next day.
Oh my God.
She calls me back the next day. She'll send me stuff from Facebook pretending that I'm going to know what she's talking about, but I go go onto her Facebook page, I have no clue what she, you know, there's like a whole, it's like a whole day's worth of shit. You know, it's right there, but I have no idea what she wanted me to see. Anyway, she drives me crazy. it's a good thing she's so good looking, or I'd be out of there. Anyway, neglecting responsibilities to be online, allowing relationships to deteriorate with spouses, coworkers, family, and friends, posting more messages and downloading more and more data, eating in front of the monitor. How many of you eat in front of your, while you're playing Candy Crush? No? Okay, good. Checking your email more than once a day. Some internet addicts see oblivion wanting to zone out while others seek frequent or constant interaction. They're seeking some kind of interaction. This tends to be more likely if they are looking at pornography. They're looking for constant stimulation. Physical symptoms of internet overuse include blurred vision, chronic lack of sleep, twitching mouse fingers, relationship problems. If you've ever been around a kid that's a gamer, a lot of times he'll have twitchy thumbs. As stupid as that sounds, they'll have joint problems in their thumbs because they're pushing so hard. I don't know. I don't understand this stuff. It's like this, isn't it? The list of internet addictions includes cybersexual addiction, computer relationship addiction, internet compulsions, information addiction, computer games addiction, phishing. Catfishing, I'm sorry, isn't that what they call it? Catfishing, where you change your profile to be the opposite sex and you try to seduce people online. Isn't that the catfishing? Didn't they have a television show about... They did, didn't they? We're the only ones that understand this thing. The rest of you guys are just lost, okay. Catfishing, yeah, computer games, and of course computer games. I used to have a friend, how do I have enough time? When I was living in Washington, D.C., I had a friend that, she was living with her sister, and her sister was married to this guy, and they had three computers, and they were back to back, and they would play games, and sometimes she wouldn't sleep at night, because they were playing some kind of World of Warcraft, that's what they play. Anyway, and this was their relationship. You know, I mean, here's a husband and wife, and they never go to bed. They just play video games, and they take naps at select times, and all three of them are just playing video games all night. Now, here's the kicker. She's got a daughter, and her daughter was the one that was cooking. She's like 6 years old, and she's cooking for all three of these adults. I know, it was the dumbest thing in the world. But they were that addicted to gaming, and they played this World of Warcraft all night long, and sometimes she'd come to work and she just, it looked like she partied all night long, but she'd been on the internet all night, as stupid as that sounds. Computer relationship addiction entails individuals dealing more and more in their online fantasy world. They pull more and more away from their real relationships until they lose those relationships. Eventually, the addict's cyber world replaces and becomes the most important aspect of their life. And of course, we've seen this on television and we laugh about it when we see it. But the reality is there are people who identify more with their avatar than they do with who they actually are. This is real. And these people are in trouble. And of course, you're going to have to be dealing with this sometime in the future. We need to stop right here. I didn't get very far. I'm sorry. I told too many stories.